If you see the cyber security as an industry has evolved in too many areas. Okay, so if you see that overall in the industry, we are into a constant match with the cyber criminals. The industry comes out with the new products, new technologies, and cyber criminals brings out new ways of hacktivism. They find the new ways to penetrate. So today, from a Securite perspective, what we are trying to address is an enterprise space with a unified security concepts. So when I said that unified security, we talk about from an infrastructure security perspective and moving the needle to application security and moving the needle to towards the data center security. Today, what we talk about is not only the endpoint security or a network security, but we try to basically build down the solutions which actually can address data protection, right? And most of the enterprise in the enterprise space, right, when the perimeter is diminishing, and one of the new fundamentals which is coming as cloud, and this pandemic has also accelerated this cloud adoption in a very faster way. So that is where the cloud security becomes one of the most important elements, and all those customers which basically are working with the remote offices, so they want an agility in terms of the how they want to manage security over the cloud. So today, when we look at the Securite, so Securite, from a product perspective, we are addressing an information security, we are addressing an infrastructure security, we are addressing the space of application security, and we are also addressing the space of data center security, right, which includes some of the the products which can go into the private cloud also. So and plus, what we are trying to do is that we are trying to help with our customers with lot of professional services and consulting services, for example, vulnerability assessment and penetration services. For example, we are trying to build a services portfolio to help our customers to recognize the gaps and do an assessment in their network architecture, in their application architecture, so that we can provide them the entire demographics of the gaps that they have, and with our products and with our services, they can fill in those gaps and create a secure architecture for their infrastructure. Okay, so that is what we Securite today is all about. So overall, if you see from the last few times when we have been into the lockdown, right, one of the core fundamental, we have observed it, that there has been an intense rise in the cyber attacks, right? Some of the cyber attacks has been into the mode of where the whole intention is all about to get, and those are basically the monetarily or financial led initiatives from the cyber criminals, right? But the most important factor that we see today, all of those attacks are very targeted attacks. They are highly sophisticated in nature attacks, right? And normally we were aware about that predominantly email and web were the two larger scale of attacks that most of the cyber criminal uses. So today, if you see, the most of the compromises that most of the cyber criminals today try to build their hacktivism via email and web, because those are the primary two sectors. But I think that the third important sector, what they have also done, is the mobility. So we have seen some of the rising attacks coming from the mobility. And also, one of the more important observations that we had during the pandemic, the current trend is basically on an API abuses. If you see today in this universal world, what is happening is, not the universal, but what I call as the secular information world. What is happening is that, we are basically getting surrounded by all around the APIs, right? If you see today, most of the people are using APIs. The way we live our life is also building a dependency on APIs. what does that mean? That means the way we shop. We shop today, the online shopping has abruptly, during this pandemic, the online shopping has abruptly increased because people are not taking up the chances to go out and shop. So similarly, if you see, the people are now getting adapted to book their taxis via online. People are adapted to basically order their food online. Okay, so even in our day to day, the way we lead our lives, you know, the entire API, is growing up. The entire API, there's an explosion of APIs, right? Because everything is becoming application dependent, and each of the application is triggering up multiple applications in return. For example, if you are booking a taxi, right, you know, the GPS API becomes one of the explosions. The, you know, billing becomes one of the connections to those applications. So one application has inherently connections all across to the multiple applications. And those APIs are actually the exposure of APIs are getting evolved. And we are getting surrounded by APIs all around us. So today, if you see that, even in the Gartner also says that the API abuses are fundamentally one of the prime areas where we should be concerned, and those areas are growing. The API abuses, the API security is also becoming one of the big challenges, right? Then second portion that I want to talk about is that today there is a big, as you said, that this pandemic actually accelerated the cloud adoption. And when I say that this acceleration of the cloud adoption is a big way, a transformation of becoming borderless. If you remember, I talked about the perimeter is diminishing. There are not much attacks which are being visible from the north south. Okay, so which means the perimeter based attacks are actually coming down and the insider attacks are growing. Okay, so when we see those, the insider attacks are growing, so that means the workload, the cloud security is fundamentally one of the most important aspect, right, that people wants to. And second, one of the observations that we had, well, people were depending on having on-prem solutions. They wanted to protect their endpoint assets. So normally, people used to basically deploy an on-prem solutions to protect their assets. But now, since the entire pandemic accelerated a borderless kind of a concept, now people are moving towards the solutions which are cloud oriented. The solutions which are basically oriented towards which can help the remote users to be secured, right? Now, mobility has brought down to an aspect, the person can be anywhere. The data is at rest, the data is moving between data centers, data is moving between public to private clouds, data centers to their DRs, it's all across. Internet users are growing, roaming users are growing. Now, the fundamental is how this architecture can be supported by the cybersecurity companies, which actually can reduce the surface attacks for those enterprises. And that is where QuickHeal, is working on whether it's a roaming users, whether it's basically an enterprise customer. So and whether it is on cloud, so we have our solutions ready for all modes and for all mechanics. And we can provide a complete coverage. We can provide a complete secured architecture. In a way, we can basically cover up them in order to bring them a very robust, secured environments. Today, when we were looking at, if you look at the rise or in the volume of hacktivism for SMPs, right, that is predominantly growing. Okay. And if you look at that, there has been instances, right, where, some of the data theft, some of the identity theft has happened in some of the large enterprises during these times, right? Overall, if you see, whatever national cybercrime records also say, they also keep on saying that the number of fraudulents has also increased. Whether it is from a consumer perspective or whether it's from an enterprise perspective, the rise in the volume of attacks is higher, has been higher during this pandemic. Okay. Now, definitely that is something where there could be two notions, because it was an abruptly that all the customers, all the enterprises had to basically do a transformation. They had to basically, during the lockdown, they have to service to the remote users majorly. And this shift has been from on-prem to the cloud. That's what I said. Because if you see that most of the customers were on the on-prem solutions, they were actually working towards moving down the cloud and building a robust environment for remote users. But during this pandemic accelerated it. It did not give them the chance to basically do a proper migration and transformation. So they have to take steps quite drastically, urgently, and that gave up a space to cyber criminals to immediately penetrate and catch this opportunity. Right. But somehow, what we have seen, that most of the enterprises have been successfully able to migrate and transform and build a security posture for their enterprises. Secureight is basically our cybersecurity evangelism, the way we thought of cybersecurity, right? We thought of not only from a product centric, we were always a solution centric, right? I think that paid us very well off, because during the time, if you look at that, as I said, that the Secureight was always focusing towards a unified, cybersecurity space. So we were never logically a point product company, right? We were always thinking of, the breaches that can come around. We were always doing a predictive analysis that how cyber criminals can exploit the current gaps of the modern enterprises, right? And that is where our R&D was actually working, in a very highly innovative state, right? Our R&D was in the high state of innovation, because I think we were completely ready with all set of solutions, because we had already, solutions for remote users. We had already, from the endpoint perspective and from the network perspective, we were always ready with, managing the network-based traffic through VPN and the secure channels. Okay. And we were able to provide a completely support to all our on-prem customers, right? And we were ready to basically either help them in creating a secured posture while they were on the on-prem for their remote users. Also, if the customers wanted to migrate to cloud, and we were all ready for them, because we gave them that sophistication, we gave them that state of art of technology to migrate to our cloud as well. Okay, so in a way, what I wanted to say is that, while the whole industry was working, while people were actually figuring out that how the cloud is going to be, but we were quite innovative in our technological space, and we were ready with all kind of probabilities, and that helped us during this pandemic, because whether it was a remote user from an endpoint perspective or from a network perspective, we were able to create a secure posture for him, or whether the person who basically wanted to basically abruptly migrate to cloud, and that whole environment was ready for him. So we were all set ready. We did not let our customers to suffer. And we were the ones which were basically, our services and support was up and running, and we helped some of the people to migrate to the remote, and we created some of the secure channels to help them in order to work efficiently and securely. We as the Secureight, we are a highly, a partner and customer centric organization. Okay. And when the lockdown mode started, right, I think the first thing that came to our mind is basically how to keep our support active, right? The first thing that our IT, internal corporate IT, worked on, that how to basically enforce and ensure that how everyone, how our toll frees are not getting impacted, our toll frees are working down the line. And they impacted that all of our engineers via web and chat are all there, right? Whatever the infrastructure we needed to give to the people to work from their home, we immediately, made those investments, and we made that shift. And the good part was I think that shift that we made for our support was in less than 2 to 3 days. We ensured that all our support guys is up and working from home. So whatever investments we need to do, we made a quick investments. We ensured everything is there, and people have their internet connections. People have their, people have access. People have access to critical servers. People are operating out of their laptops. They are able to. They're not missing. The call abundances are not done. You know, we are not missing any customer requests. So that was, I think, the first 1 week after the lockdown was like, you know, even before the lockdown, when we were actually feeling that, you know, some crisis situation is going to come up. So we have, our HR has already set up, disaster recovery DR plans. And DR plans, you know, we had a steering committee there. And that committee, the first thing that they worked on is basically how to keep our support up and coming. That was one thing. Then second thing, what we do is that we actually use that time, well efficient time, the first quarter of this year, we use in basically, use that time in building the, in scaling up the competency levels of partners. So I think in a month, if we used to have 2 or 3 programs, we immediately, for partner trainings, we immediately move to the digital platform, right? We started basically, learning information management services. We started training partners. And in fact, those smaller cities where, maybe the infrastructure was an issue, our local teams, over the WebEx, over the collaborative applications, they started reaching out to the partners, building them up and, gaining their confidence and telling them more about our offerings, telling them more about imparting them the trainings. Okay. So when it comes down to, how we dealt with the situation, the first thing we was that, we are not going to let our customers down when they need the support. So we were up and ready with all relevant infrastructure. We did fast investments, very quick investments to build that infrastructure. Wherever we needed to build in, wherever we had gaps, we were all set and ready. And I think there is hardly any customer who comes back to us and says that he was not supported during the pandemic. And I think I got so many appreciation letters during this pandemic, and the customers were amazingly to see, how you guys have managed it. I think the good part that Seqrite has is our local presence, right? We are present in every damn city, right? We have technical people, we have sales people, we have pre-sales people in every city, you name it. So wherever we are selling, right, our first objective was that how do we give the return, how do we return the value to our customers, right? The customers who have invested on us, how do we retain that value to them? So that is where our force was a big, it was a big strength of ours. Our force all across was a big strength, and they ensured that all the customers are attended. And during that time, they ensured also the partners are very well connected. We kept on talking to partners, understanding their pain areas, understanding that how we can help them. And partners were like as a buddies to us, and we started, every local team used to talk to our partners at the local level to figure it out that what does it mean to be as a local go to market with those partners, right? We build a foundational plans at the local levels, at the grassroots levels, at the field levels, so as that what is the appropriate way to engage with, and we build it them. And overall, if you see from support till partner engagements, partner enablements, that kept us moving on, and that kept us at customer satisfaction. Our customer satisfaction scores are very, very exorbitantly very high, which means there is a very, very, nicely, the customers have really appreciated the way we have supported them. Our CSAT scores are very absorbently very high. Earlier, I used to say that, I used to find a very lot of difficulty in finding up a CISO, because he was building, he was meeting so many people. Okay. And I think now this digital transformation has also eased because your travel time has gone. So but unfortunately that travel time has become very productive now, because that 1 or 2 hours of travel time that we used to take now is getting actually converted into meetings, right? So online meetings. So now the chances of having meeting ratio with the CISOs is also increasing now, and CISOs is also now adapting to this kind of a culture. I told you now, it's a cultural shock for both of us, right? You know, because CISO never used to agree on something until unless you're not in front of him, and we also never used to get that comfort until unless we are not in front of him. Okay, but then both of us had to struggle a lot to basically come to a negotiation level where we could actually see and get adapted to this digital environment, right? But one of the good things is that we are now observing that it is becoming more productive. Those web meetings are becoming more productive because you are coming on time, you are leaving on time, you have a meeting, you have meeting schedule on time that you are following, right? And as the travel times are now almost eliminated because the people were not traveling, that time was actually getting used by them to do meetings. So chances of having the meetings were much more. Chances of having the appointments rather were much more. Security. It looks like to me there are all vendors in security. It's a cluttered market, right? But fundamentally, I think cybersecurity is the only industry where the level of innovation is quite higher, because you have to be innovative, otherwise your cyber criminals will take over you, right? And when it comes about, when the Seqrite, Seqrite as a company, when we think about, right, we don't think about a consumerization, we don't think about productization. During the pandemic, a lot of other companies had to think about that, what will happen to this product, how it can be tuned, right? While as we were already ready, because we were ready for on-prem kind of solutions, we were ready for cloud-based solutions, we were ready for remote solutions. So the moment that work from home triggered in, so all that remote users, right, automatically became the part of my security posture, because my products had that ability to build a securized posture for all those kind of remote users, right? And when people who were actually getting scanned from the on-prem servers, and abruptly they found that now they need a vendor or a service provider which has a cloud-based interface, and they don't need to go out to hunt anyone else other than us because we were already there, okay? So when it comes to the, today when I look at that Seqrite, so my pride goes always that Seqrite is not a one product or a two product company, right? Seqrite is a unified cyber security solutions company, because whether the attack is from endpoint, whether the attack is from network, or whether the attack is from an application stack, right? So we try to basically, we have a visualization, right? We try to visualize all the attack surfaces, and we help the customers to basically minimize those surface attacks with our products and technologies. And my biggest thought was towards that, how do I create a value for the investments that the customers have made on us, right? And out of that, my bigger primary focus was on the critical infrastructure. As I said to you that I worked on a two-point strategy there. The one-point strategy was that, I had in every city some of the local guys, support guys, which I kept, which may be required for field presence for those customers, right? And plus, I ensured that there is a proper duty manager assigned, right? I worked out with my support head, and the support head ensured that there is a properly subject matter expertise, a duty manager, which is basically recognized for all those critical infrastructures, okay? And during the course of time, we kept our channel also ready, because we, all the channel partners which are managing those critical infrastructures, we actually, partnered with them. We ensured that they are also ready in case of something, some bottleneck start comes in, okay? That was the one thing. The second point program, which really, we wanted that, the healthcare is also very important. We have a lot of healthcare customers as well, okay? And how then, because my fundamental approach was that the healthcare, which was serving the nation at that point in time, right? And IT and automation was of the primary importance to them. The IT environment should not crack down, okay? So from the healthcare, we actually created what you call as a personal touch. You know, we basically we created a proactive influence towards those accounts, right? Where we proactively we generally as a company, you know, as a security, right? We generally do a lot of proactive audits to our customers to do a health check of their networks. That's a habit that we have. The way Seqrite today manages its customers, we proactively do a lot of health check for our customers. But during the pandemic, we basically regularized the cycles of health checks. You know, we said that let us, because these are critical infrastructures and the healthcare is important because they're serving the nation at that point in time. So let's make a regular healthcare check with them. So that is how we created a healthcare check for them. So we continue to see BFSI as the primary, segment, who basically continues to show concern on the cybersecurity, obviously, because the financial segment is the one of the segments which is basically on the top radars of the cyber criminals. And that industry always wants to remain ahead of the cyber criminals. So financial sector continues to be it. But then overall, what I saw is that about one of the observations that we had, that e-commerce companies were the second largest, which actually showed a lot of traction, right? Because I think one of the biggest reason was that, entire shopping spree went onto the online, like, Zomato's of the world, Swiggy's of the world, Flipkart's of the world, right? So they showed a lot of traction, like Urban Clubs and Pepper Fries. So those e-commerce companies, online, who have a basically online shopping spree, those companies started showing up a lot of traction, right? And then the third was like, all those companies which were basically relatedly, what you call as pharma and healthcare, right? So pharma and healthcare also abruptly the notion of cybersecurity came up. Because I think at that point in time, I was more importantly seeing the healthcare was very, very concerned that we should not get any other attack, because that attack would have got them into the denial of service mode, right? So they could have not served their customers the way they could have. So that is why I think the healthcare also did a great job in basically proactively talking to vendors as how can they keep their systems alive.
For more updates from CXO TV, please like and subscribe to our channel.